And there's a very good reason for it. It seems to capture the imagination of not just a few people, but of the whole of mankind. I mean, one of the most wonderful moments of the 20th century was the falling down of the Berlin Wall, and Leonard Bernstein, in one of his last performances, doing the Ninth Symphony with the Ode to Joy with new words. And that's just one example of many. Beethoven is always relevant and always dynamic for society in every generation. What I find incredible is the way Beethoven's music keeps reinventing itself, or rediscover, or how each generation seems to rediscover the music anew. Last year was going to be an unbelievably exciting celebration of Beethoven's 250th anniversary, and of course, the sad business of COVID cancelled so much of it. But nonetheless, there were still some wonderful online festivals, many online events, and one of the great triumphant publications was Jonathan Del Mar's new edition of the Beethoven 35 sonatas. It was originally 32, according to Czerny, but Barry Cooper in Manchester, another great Beethoven scholar, reminded us that there were actually 35 versions. So Baron Reuter last year did a brand new edition of all the Beethoven sonatas, which showed them all in a completely different light, reinvented them for the 21st century. That follows on from, as I've mentioned, Barry Cooper in Manchester at the University. Barry is a local scholar, but actually, arguably, the greatest Beethoven scholar in the world, certainly in the United Kingdom. He's the man who has not only reconstructed the 10th Symphony, but produced a reconstruction of the original version of the violin concerto for the Associated Board, produced an amazing edition of the sonatas. And when I'm saying, you know, Beethoven's reinvented and will always be young, I'm not talking about things that only academics can discover. I mean, Barry Cooper's edition, for example, if you think of the Opus 90 sonata, and we've got a wonderful phrase in the Opus 90 sonata. Discovered that, you know, interpreting the manuscript, in his opinion, sonata. Now, before Beethoven, we were in the world of patronage, and the composers were like bakers and candlestick makers and gardeners. They were working for courts, like Haydn and Esterhazy. Mozart tried to become freelance, but he wasn't quite of the right generation. The world wasn't quite ready for the tragedy of Mozart dying in a pauper's grave. But Beethoven was able to not have that quite so much. Of course, he was very, very indebted to rich patrons, but he was on his own. He was able to be a kind of first composer pianist, a kind of pop star of Vienna, the kind of Elton John of his time, if you like, and somebody who people would flock to hear for virtuosity, for his improvisation. I mean, we forget what an extraordinary improviser Beethoven was. But the actual piano sonatas themselves, these early Opus 2 sonatas, this set of Opus 2, we're going to hear the third one, dedicated to Haydn, and they're ferociously difficult. I mean, they show you just what an athlete of the keyboard Beethoven was, an iconoclast, somebody who was pushing forward and creating. turning the piano into an orchestra, straining the instrument, making the instrument, forcing manufacturers to make bigger and stronger and adding notes to the instrument all the time. So we'll hear the Opus 2, number 3 sonata, complete in the first movement with a cadenza, almost as though Beethoven's turning the first movement into a concerto. And then this huge extended adagio, which takes the music out of planet Earth, almost into space travel in terms of the way that the melody flows. And then we have not a minuet and trio like in Haydn and Mozart, but a scherzo and trio, which sort of adds the energy and the force. And then we have this very witty finale. It says at the start of the music it could be played on the piano or the harpsichord. I think playing it on the harpsichord would be quite a challenge. And I think certainly Beethoven's old instruments often capitulated under the pressure of the demands. We've got a wonderful shibboleth here. We've got Yuba, who's going to play Opus 2, number 3. So let's give her a round of applause.
Thank you. Thank you.
happiness is forgetting about your woes and troubles, forgetting about the ego, and losing yourself in the universality. And I think that's one of the amazing things about this music, that in all its periods, it takes you away from your own woes and concerns. I mean, I have to say, I'm thinking at the moment about the very tacky and very amusing 1980s film made in America called The Piano Competition. Do any of you remember that one? Richard Dreyfuss. It's a love story about two people that end up getting first and second prize. But the winner of the competition, the girl, her piano teacher, is giving her a bit of conciliatory advice. And she's worried about whether she's good enough to play Beethoven in the competition. And the piano teacher says, "For goodness sake, the great teacher of the Juilliard said that your Wolfstein sonata made her forget her sciatica." So if any of you have got backache, I'm sure Mr. Lewis Wolfstein will help you forget your sciatica. But seriously, in all its periods and all its glory, that's what Beethoven was doing, was taking us away from reality. And in the middle period that we're coming to now, after the early period, he was doing this in the most incredibly economical way, and taking scraps of material. I mean, the violin concerto, one of the most sublime works ever written, is basically just... that's all it is. He writes this amazing, lyrical, unbelievable 45, 50 minute sublime lyrical masterpiece based on that. And of course, we all know about... which comes everywhere. I mean, my colleague Jonathan Middleton has found that motif in all 32 of the sonatas. And in the very first one. I mean, he's obsessed with the fate motif and the sense of destiny. Beethoven in the middle period taking scraps of material but extending the time range of music. And the Wolfstein sonata, we're going to hear the first movement of it. Originally it had an Andante Favore as the second movement, but his friends told him to take it out. With the Andante Favore, the sonata would have lasted nearly 40 minutes. As it is, the sonata with just a one-page slow movement and two huge extended movements is well over 23 minutes. But not only that, it's taking very, very, very simple, almost childlike motifs and turning them into the most sublime, spiritual, monumental, extraordinary structures. That's the genius of Beethoven, finding en route different harmonies, different textures, new pianistic challenges, stretching music in all directions. So, Minsong is going to play the first movement of the Wolfstein sonata.
Thank you.
writing this sonata a few years later, Beethoven's hearing became unbelievably seriously damaged. And to think that he wrote all his music in his late period without being able to hear any notes, it doesn't begin, we can't begin to imagine the suffering and the transcendental power that came from his pen when he wrote music that was really going way beyond reality to an extraordinary extent. We think of works, of course you think of the Diabelli variations, you think of the Ninth Symphony, but I mean the Hammer Clavier Sonata, opus 106, Igor Stravinsky wrote it, will always remain modern, and it still shocks listeners today. And of course the sublime heights of the last three Beethoven piano sonatas and the late string quartets. Would Beethoven have been able to write music of such incredible inward beauty and transcendental power if he hadn't been deaf? Well, there's an open question, but it's certainly unbelievably moving and extremely inspiring and something that we all think about all the time. Beethoven and Manchester, we've talked about Professor Barry Cooper, but of course Sir Charles Halley and the Halley Orchestra. Charles Halley was the person who first performed the complete cycle of Beethoven sonatas in the United Kingdom in Manchester. So we have a great connection with the Halley Orchestra. The discoveries of Beethoven continue afoot. I was amazed just 2 weeks ago to be given a new book by Universal Edition of lots of little Beethoven pieces, not the sonatas, but the bagatelles and the polonaise and fantasy. But included in this collection was a new one-page bagatelle which the editor had stumbled across by chance in a library in between the manuscript copy of the Missa Solemnis, a new undiscovered bagatelle, a charming six-line piece. And so it was published for the first time in this year. And really, you know, Beethoven's discoveries continue. Barry Cooper discovered bagatelles by Beethoven in the 1990s that had been unearthed and had been left forgotten and undiscovered for well over 100 years. So the youthful quality that continues to surprise us about this wonderful body of music will continue. We're going to finish with Rose playing the sonata in E-flat, opus 31, number 3. In the first movement, Beethoven is like a youth with a toy, or a boy with a toy, has discovered a wonderful added sixth chord. Henry at the college pointed out today to Rose that actually that's a mirror image. If you take B-flat as the point of symmetry, the hands are in complete symmetry. So it's very, very clever. But he's obsessed with this chord, and he takes it in new contexts. It's like putting litmus paper. You can see different colours coming. And rhythm, my goodness me, talk about youthful enthusiasm and motoric genius in the finale. It's often called the hunt, this sonata, this unbelievable energy that comes also in the scherzo movement, but in the sublime lyrical miniature, that's the third movement, which Sanson's used the trio of as a set of variations for two pianos, we have some extremely piercing dissonances which are included really remarkably eloquently into the texture, which are, you know, quite outrageous but done in such a very, very craftsman-like way that it's really a mark of genius. So here we have the opus 31, number 3 sonata in E-flat.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.